All right, here we go. Hey guys, what's up? Welcome to DeltaHalo. This is episode 25. I am your host, Sergeant. Got MattyIce and Cat over there. What's up, guys? You been playing much Halo this week?
Sergeant, I did get in quite a few games of free-for-all SWAT.
Oh, you actually played that?
Yeah, it's ridiculous. Well, it's ridiculously fun. First off, I want to say how stupid it is that you can't team join in a social playlist.
Well, yeah, that's the point of a social playlist.
Who cares if we want to fill it up full of our friends? It doesn't matter. Nothing matters.
That's a very good point.
That bugged me. But nobody was playing, so I got to jump in. And I was getting overkills left and right. I mean, I had the first game. Yeah, right?
I roll.
I don't know if you can go on and view full matches, but you guys can if you can get on my Halo gamer tag. No, but I mean, but the games were to 50. That was crazy. They weren't to 25. They were to 50. Game. Yeah, super long game. So it was more a game of endurance after a while.
Yes.
But no, it was tons of fun, and I got to play a ton of Overwatch beta.
Oh, you tried that out too?
Loved it. I loved it. I played a lot of it. I'd actually be playing it right now if we weren't doing this.
Yeah, we kind of went hard on the Overwatch for a little bit. We did switch, play some Halo the other night. But yeah, we played quite a bit, actually. I played, what, a couple hours in the Halo? And I was bad at that point.
Was today the last day?
Nope, it's still going tonight. It ends at 10 o'clock Pacific time tomorrow.
Okay. Yeah, I'm going to play it after this.
All right.
Yeah.
That's cool. I liked it. I wasn't crazy about it. I don't know what it is about the game. It's fun. It's a good changeup, but I don't know. There's something about it that just didn't hook me. There were a few players like Pharah, which was fun. D.Va was fun. I don't know. Maybe it's a different experience once you get more people in your party and start playing together, but I found it to be, and I mean, and also it was a beta, so it's hard to really put much of an opinion behind it, but I found it to be basically just like a filler or a change up where you change it up from Halo and then come back to Halo. But I will say the one time that we played it on what day were we playing it last week? Thursday? We played it Thursday quite a bit, I think, right? Mm-hmm. And then switched back to Halo, and that was such a huge freaking changeup. I don't know if you guys noticed it when you went back, but without the sprint, like when you're just running around, it is so much slower than Overwatch until you like sprint and start moving around. I was really thrown off at first making the switch back.
I love the switch back. The Overwatch not really having any recoil or anything was really is pretty weird. I went back to Halo, I was a million times better at Halo. It was something that I should just play Overwatch and then go play Halo, and I'm a lot better at it. I had that with another game too. I feel like Destiny always made me better at Halo too. It's really weird, just because my mind is so tuned around Halo because that's what I started with, and that's what I think all my basic skills are based off of. When I do something a little weird, then go back to Halo. Halo is just like my normal feeling, and I can just like zone into it a lot better. I don't know. It's really weird, but I mean, every time when I went to Call of Duty and back to Halo, I played Halo better just because Halo was a little bit slower.
Well, yeah, that's the way I think that it was for me for Overwatch. Like, it was, like, kind of frantic. I mean, once you played it more, you got more used to it. But it's still kind of like, I don't know, the players move, like the player movement, the characters move so much quicker across the map. Whereas Halo, you're not focusing on a target that's strafing back and forth that quick, so you can definitely slow down. And I totally get it, switching back to Halo can make you feel like you're playing better because it's just different. It's slower, and I totally get what you're saying. It just threw me off. I went the complete other direction because I was still in like Overwatch fast mode, and I was moving slow, and I just like couldn't get out of the way when I expected to. It was more on the defensive side rather than the offensive side, I think, that was throwing me off.
Yeah. Halo is just, it shows you after you play a game like that Halo is such a better mechanic competitive shooter wise. I mean, like the headshots, everything feels
completely
a lot
different
more,
game.
Yeah, it is.
Shooting wise, it's good.
Well, yeah, right.
But I mean, it's just like that kind of first person shooter to this kind. Halo just feels so different than everything else. It's like a lot more accurate. I feel like your skill level just has to be a lot higher. Yeah,
it's a class of its own. Kind of like
I think their Destiny shooting is so awesome. Too. Like there's like the how the auto aim works in Halo. Everything is just so dialed in, and it makes you really appreciate the time that they take to put into Halo to make it like that good. Seeing how Overwatch is a new game and this is really new, mm-hmm. whereas Halo's had the years to like dial that in. And you, I mean,
well, I don't think you're ever going to get that out of something like Overwatch, though. It's not supposed to be.
It's true. It's true. That they type of game. That's completely from Team Fortress.
Much more positioning and stuff like that.
It definitely had Team Fortress feel to it. More in my mind, it definitely had more teamwork based because I don't know, and I can't really talk too much because I played some Team Fortress, but I got so lost playing that game. But Overwatch, you are so dependent on your teammates. You run into teams that use tanks well, use all the different roles very well. You get mm-hmm. you get wrecked. It's, and it's cool because it's very focused on team and not necessarily on shooting skill, which some of the people do. I mean, you definitely need to understand what your moves are, but team plays a very big role.
It's the same thing in Team Fortress, though. I actually played a lot of Team Fortress. I really got into it. And like the roles in that, having the machine gunner, the tank machine gunner, and everything, like you do see team roles in that, and it's crazy that they're taking payload. They're taking the basic characters. You got your bow and arrow character, your sniper character. The graphics? Did I say the graphics? They honestly look just like Team Fortress.
Well, they don't.
Yes, they do. It's got a team. I mean, they also it have also that kind plays- of World of Warcraft feel, but which is really cool. But it's got it's the same like color texture. Like it's. They have the tunnels with the railroads that go through it. I don't know. It's very, very, very similar.
That's one map. That's the one, like, Western
it's
map.
It's the whole feeling for it, I think. And honestly, when I was playing it, I was contemplating on if I remember Blizzard buying Team Fortress in order to use so much of their stuff in it.
Dude, WoW has done half those game modes and stuff like that forever in Battlegrounds and everything.
I know. It's true. It's true. They do have all that stuff, but I mean, playing Team Fortress, they just feel so like each other. I like it a lot.
I didn't see the Team Fortress. I mean, I get it, the class characters and stuff like that, being that type of shooter. But again, you think the game plays completely differently as far as that goes. I mean, it's much faster in Overwatch, especially depending on which character you use.
It's better. I mean, it's like a Team Fortress game that's had, well, I mean, that came out, what, 15 years ago or something?
How old is that game?
Team Fortress game is how I feel. Like, Team Fortress, if Team Fortress were to be built in 2016, I feel like it would just be that game.
Sure.
Yeah.
Could be my opinion. Maybe other people have that opinion. Who knows?
Yeah. Well, welcome to episode 25, guys. We are recording this video as we do every week. Now that we got that out of the way, you can check this video out on Wednesday of this week once we get it uploaded to YouTube, Espawn Gaming on YouTube. And you can follow us on Twitter at @part_time_elite. And it would be fantastic if you gave us a rating and review on iTunes. We got a few on there right now. And we would really love you if you went up there and did this rating and review for us. I really appreciate that.
In your loins.
In the loins.
Hey, we hit 100 individual listens on an episode in our SoundCloud app.
I saw that. I think we had one early on when we were probably in like the new section and like we popped up and people listened to it, but we haven't had one probably 20 episodes. So that was a huge, huge milestone for us. So thank you guys, everybody, for listening and spreading the word and telling your friends about it. We really, really appreciate it. And get your trivia answers in, because I just want to do a quick update of that. So we got a bunch of answers in last minute today and yesterday. And I think we probably got like 4 or 5 people to answer. I think we got 5 or 6 answers, actually. And we got 3 people correct this week. So if you remember back to last week, the sound from the multiplayer map was the question. And the answer was Colosseum. We got a bunch of guesses for Truth, and we got a guess for Torque, a bunch of different maps, but it was Colosseum. The sound was coming from the red and blue base. There's those two like platforms in the middle of the bases where those armor plates kind of open up and then close, and that's where that was coming from. So congrats to Real Mystery, Roach, and Method for getting that question correct. I know you wanted to give Method your point, Mystery, but you're on the board. We can't transfer points, and Method got it right also. So you both got points for this round, and that that brings the scoreboard up to, gosh, Roach is out in the lead right now with 4 points. He's kind of running away with it a little bit. We got Trax at 2, VBG at 2, Wayne at 2, Duyo with 1, Method with 1. Travis from Drunken Halo put his hat in the ring this week, so thank you, Travis, for guessing. Unfortunately, you had the wrong guess, so you're still at 0. And Mystery with 1. Good job, guys. We just want to let you know. What's up, Kat?
I was going to say kudos. You guys had to get in the maps and run around and just figure it out. Like, that's so cool.
Yeah, I love that. I think it was Roach that sent us an email. He's like, yeah, I actually had to go in. You made me work for this one. I went to Custom Games and I was checking out like all the different maps and finally found Coliseum. So that's really cool. That's like, we really appreciate you guys taking that time to jump in and have to figure that out. But Method, got to give him a little bit of a shout out. He kind of gave us some encouragement to get our Delta Halo shirts to the printer. So we have a whole run of those going right now. And if you didn't have incentive enough to get the respect for being at the top of the leaderboard, now you can win a Delta Halo t-shirt. We'll tweet out what that graphic looks like. Maddie's holding his up in the video right now. We're getting those at the end of this week, probably. They're in the printer. They're pretty sweet. And you could have one if you end up having the most points at the end of each month. So we'll start a new trivia season, essentially. And then at the end of the month, if you have the most points, you win a shirt. So it does pay to answer these trivia questions now. You got to be on it each week.
It pays to play.
It pays to play.
And for our YouTubers.
And Kat's got a Master Chief shirt on.
That's a vintage one back in Halo 3 launch.
And if you don't win a shirt from trivia, we still have those available. DM us on Twitter. We'll let you know how you can snag one of those once we get them. But those will be coming up quick. And just to do an update from game night this past week. So this was our second game night, second week in a row that we've done it. And we had a really great turnout this week. What did we get up to? Eight people probably. We're doing a little bit of 4-on-4.
Mm-hmm.
And
man, it was so much fun.
Kat, you've downloaded some sweet maps and game types for this one.
It's true.
Yeah. Sumo, what a crazy little game mode that was.
So talk through that one real quick.
Yeah, so Sumo. Yeah, I mean, I was just downloading these maps, and you know, they don't have the photos on the file share, so it does make it actually really hard now that I've got to play around with it.
Yeah.
Do you find, that's what, like, she said. Okay, I'll try that because the title sounds really good. Good one, Maddie.
It's hysterical.
Sumo, it's a custom-made map. It's got basically garage bays all the way around it. And you spawn, you hop on a mongoose, and everybody drives to the center of the arena, which is just a square. And you try to flip each other over. When somebody flips over, they blow up, and they're out. So it's last man, basically king of the hill, last man standing wins. But as you're playing, this actually took me like 5 games to figure out this is happening because I was so confused. But first, the garages drop away. They're off the map. So if you go off into your garage bay, you actually fall off the map. And then as time goes on, rings around the square get smaller. So the outer ring will disappear. And if you're sitting on that with your mongoose, like hiding from the other characters, you'll drop off the map and lose. Mm-hmm. So you always have to be constantly fighting over the center of the map. It was crazy.
Yeah.
It was
fun. They did a very good job creating that one. That was awesome. That was a really good find.
Yeah, some epic mongoose rolls. I came out of the gate, across the other person, hit him right in the face. I think this was right.
Yeah, I think it was Roach. Face. Yeah.
Yeah. And hit him head on. He just did a straight up backflip.
That was so ridiculous. That was awesome.
Right, I have a video of that. Maybe I'll tweet it out later.
Oh, you saved that?
I saved the video. Nice, yeah. Nice.
Oh, that was good. Yeah, we should definitely get that.
That was insane.
We did. I downloaded a Nuketown map.
That was a Nuketown really
for
fun. Call
of Duty fans. I know how much I love Nuketown.
So, like, the crazy thing about that is that map plays really well in Call of Duty. Honestly, didn't expect it to play that well in Halo, but it was so much fun. They did. I don't know how it translated, but it was awesome.
It felt like I was using my intuition from Call of Duty. Which
You still had
a beautiful little map.
Yeah, you still had those sniper lanes down the side. Like, it played exactly the same.
Well, you couldn't quite camp as much. I remember playing that and just being able to camp in one of the houses in the back the whole time. But
yeah, because one bullet killed somebody across the map. So.
Yeah.
This. The windows are a little small. It's kind of hard to jump in and out of those, but I kind of actually like the aspect that that was hard to get into.
Yep.
They had the little garden in the back.
Yeah.
Hanging out in the garden at one point. And no, that map played awesome. I had so much fun in that. They had the garages. They had the middle bus with the opening. They had like a car on the side.
Mm-hmm.
That was a good time. We played quite a few of those. Yeah. That was a very
We played a team snipers on there even.
Which is
good.
Sergeant Bobcat just going off on our community night. I'm not sure what he was drinking that day. Even with snipers though, dude.
That's the thing. I'll never play a snipers game like that probably ever again.
Not with that attitude.
Yeah, true.
No, you went off, man. That was crazy. I couldn't even keep up with you.
Only we had that being a regular playlist, 343. That'd be nice too.
Yeah,
you know?
That would be nice.
Yeah, community playlist with that Nuketown on there. Are they legally allowed to play a Nuketown style map?
I don't know.
I can't call it Nuketown. Yeah, well, it's probably not trademarked.
Call it DeltaHalo Town.
Showtown.
Pound Town.
Yeah.
You should call it Pound Town. That I don't want to get into the best one yet. We had another one, didn't we?
Yeah, so we played Duck Hunt and Dodgeball as well.
Oh, Dodgeball. I was like Duck Hunt for the end.
Dodgeball was like a
4-on-4, two
small
courts.
Map with sticky grenades in the middle.
Yeah, you just
and
had to stick
swords.
The team. Yeah,
so they built a mini arena so you couldn't leave the arena. They had a ditch in the middle. If you went off into the middle like too far, like you'd fall in the ditch and die. And they had sticky grenades that lined up on the edges of the ditches in the front. So you don't start with grenades, you can't just start throwing them. You have to run up, grab a grenade.
Yeah, it's like dodgeball.
Yeah, it's like legitimate dodgeball. I sucked at it. I was terrible. I couldn't do anything. I would literally spawn and die every time, like 9 times in a row.
I carried hard.
The idea.
You guys had an epic comeback against. So I think my team, we were up like what 4-1, and it was to 5, and it was like
me,
Method, Roach, and Tachi, and then you guys ended up somehow coming back and taking us 5-4. That was a freaking marathon.
Yeah,
beat
Holdy.
It was 3-on-4, yeah.
Oh, yeah, it was 3-on-4. You beat us 3-on-4, too.
How's that feel?
Let's not talk about that.
Wait, who was on our team? Was Ray on our team?
No, he was on my team. It was just it was 4-on-3, yeah.
Who was on our team? I can't remember.
You and Ray.
Okay. Oh, yeah, us three. Can't remember. that was pretty crazy. And then we had Duck Hunt. So this was my favorite game of the night.
So this just shows, like, how ridiculously creative forgers have become, like what they've been able to do. I mean, this is just a small snippet of it.
I wish we had the shout out for the creator of this map, because the idea behind this game was awesome.
Mm-hmm.
I'll explain it, I guess.
Yeah, go for
it. So it's kind of tough to explain. So picture a wall, a giant wall, and there's hallways that kind of go back and forth like Donkey Kong.
Well, think about the carnival game where like the ducks. Ducks go back and forth.
And the rows.
Yeah, that's actually probably a better comparison.
Yeah, so like the ducks go back and forth, except the entire party, like fire team, is those ducks. And the back and forth course is like an obstacle course. And then you have one guy who's the hunter who sits up on a platform overlooking the entire wall with a sniper. And you have to run and dodge and get behind walls and slide and not get shot before you can get to like the end. There's, what was there, like 5 rows maybe?
Yeah, I think the 5th row, at the top row, you couldn't sprint or jump.
Yeah.
I don't even know if you could duck.
You could duck, no, you could duck.
It made you kind of glitched. Like,
yeah, that's right, you glitched. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Glitch duck, so.
That was hard to get to the end of that map.
It was hard. We did no scopes after
a while
because it was too easy to pick everyone off.
Yeah, I mean, Holdy hopped in, hit us right off the bat.
Yeah, he was killing it.
So we had to resort to no scoping, but the exciting moments you had in it were so awesome. Hiding behind the wall, and then you'll watch your last teammate as he goes, and he's trying to get around. And then we started developing new jumps around things and just trying to like go faster and stuff. It was kind of free running ish.
Yeah.
Pretty fun.
While getting, that was such a fun map. And the more ducks we had, because every time we'd start adding more, like, you guys would be joining while we were playing and we'd add another duck. Oh, man. More ducks made it so awesome. If we could get a full on party of ducks, I would lose my mind. I'd be so happy.
Ducks fly together.
Could you imagine just 15 people running across trying
to... Oh, it'd be so awesome. That'd be so much fun. I mean, custom games, like all these games. We've talked about the custom games. Like, that's all we've been playing, basically, in these game nights. And it is so much fun. Like, I forgot how awesome it is.
It's like, pretty cool.
If we could find another Tower of Power kind of map.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that'd be great.
That'd be great. Just going out and playing snipers on random maps is really fun.
Yeah, I mean, anything. It is just fun to get your party together and play custom games. And
I was saying, I like playing against you guys. Mm-hmm. Like, it's more exciting. There's some emotion behind it.
Well, it's fun because, like, everyone's in the same party. We're all, like, talking trash to each other and, like, you get to hear people's reactions when they lose like a close battle and stuff like that. And that just makes it so much fun. Like it's like you are all together, you know, like landing, even though you're not in the same room, you know,
we're actually fighting each other. And then it makes it awesome. And these game nights, they've been so fun, and there hasn't been anyone that's just got all fired up, angry for losing or something. Like,
no, it's all in fun, which is great.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, with you sniping so good, I almost threw my controller. That'll happen.
But, I mean, if you guys do want to hop into these, we'll always announce them on the podcast or we'll tweet them out. And we actually got our Spartan company up and running this past week. We've got us three, we've got Method, and we're really looking to grow the company. So if you are company-less right now, feel free to join ours. It's DeltaHalo, one word, and then podcast. So two words, DeltaHalo podcast. And go ahead and just try and join or send us a join request, and we'll accept you, get you in there for sure.
Yep.
Because we are definitely looking to grow. It's fun to just be able to have everyone together and play whenever you're on. Just send invites and things like that. So don't be afraid to hop in. But hopping into the news... There was some big stuff that happened this week with the Memories of Reach update that's coming up soon. The weekly update from Bravo revealed a lot more stuff outside of the wrecks, which is really, really encouraging. It's stuff that the community has been asking for a very long time, and stuff that they haven't been asking for also, which is, again, very cool that they continue to work on things that we might not necessarily know that we want, but when they give it to us, it's... cool, you know, it's really cool to have these add-ons. So, I mean, the main thing off the top was that they're giving a matchmaking update where you're able to select your parameters of either balanced, expanded, or focused. So currently, when you go into matchmaking, it's balanced. It's searching for a match based on your fireteam skill and network connection quality. So if you don't want to touch it, you can leave it at balanced. Everything will stay the complete same. If you want to switch it to expanded, that widens the search to first available match, reasonable skill matching, and reasonable network connection quality. And then you can probably guess what focused is. That gives you the first match based on skill and connection, but it's much more narrow. So it's like the best match that it can find for you. So it's going to take longer to find that match, but you're definitely going to be matched up with people that are very, very close to your same skill. So it's cool that they offered that, especially for people that are either higher ranks having trouble finding games, different regions having trouble finding games, just to give a little bit more flexibility into that. So it'll be interesting to see how that shakes out, if it affects people that are just playing balanced games and not really trying to change it, if they start running into people that are higher ranked or poor connection quality.
I was wondering, do you think people that are running looking for focus will grab people that are running balanced?
I don't know. I mean,
imagine so, as long as they need
to. If you're gonna slice the community in three ways, everything finding games hard probably.
No, yeah. I don't think it's gonna slice it in three ways. I think it's just gonna set that as another parameter. So it'll still find people within each of those buckets, but it's going to try harder to find them closer or further, more expanded from what you currently are rated at.
So if you're searching balanced and you come across someone who is focused, but you're the same level, you have a good connection, you'll get matched up with them, essentially. They take a little bit longer to find you, as opposed to you may get the next match, get someone that's lower than you, maybe decent connection type of thing. You know what I mean? So.
Yeah, I understand. That's some crazy algorithms they're figuring out.
Yeah. It's just great that they're able to do that now, because there was definitely a lot of people complaining, especially being in certain ranks and things like that, having trouble finding people to play.
Options are always good.
I want to play higher ranks. Yeah. I just want to get put into a champion game.
I don't know if you'd have too much fun doing that. At least I would not get
worried. I'm going to get better. I'm going to get better. 365 days until hockey season.
Yeah, toughen up.
Got to toughen up.
So, all right, so they're also adding something that I know you've been asking for a lot, Kat, and Matt, you've probably been wanting this as well. The post-game carnage report is finally being built out and coming back. So they're giving you the updates on all your medals for the match, including quantity, rarity, the description of the medals. Before, I don't even know if you could see the medals before. Nope. You see like the top one? Did you even see that?
Nope.
Anyway, they're giving you a ton more detail with the medals. You are also getting the Tool of Destruction, which is awesome. I always loved seeing that, whether it was, you know, the fist for melee or the...
Like a good old fist.
The Warthog being the driver. That's cool. Then you also have Killed Most, Killed By Most, so you can see who your nemesis is. So that's awesome. Post-game cards report. I know that's been something that people have been like, why wasn't this even in the game at launch?
Right,
you know?
Right.
I love that stuff. More stats, the better.
Yeah, it's always been in the game, so it's fantastic they're bringing it back.
It's always been in the game. It's always been awesome. I've always liked it. And I was baffled at the fact that they had the medals in the game, but you couldn't look at them afterwards.
Yeah, that didn't make sense. It still doesn't. So thankfully they're fixing it. Super yeah, like what's the point if you can't actually see after the game what you got? I'm not going to be like tallying it.
Or like you got like four of them in a row and you couldn't tell which ones you were even getting at all.
Yeah, exactly.
That's funny.
So they are also changing the fact that the Spartan Charge will no longer be a one-hit kill when you also have the speed boost equipped for Warzone, which is nice for people that play Warzone a lot. This is interesting. So I'm curious about this one. I don't know how this is going to play out. They're increasing the speed of crouching. That could either be absolutely terrible because people are going to be crouching everywhere now that there's a slight increase in speed, or it's just going to make crouching a little bit more
applicable,
have more utility so that you're not just a sitting duck, but it could get abused. I'm really kind of nervous about how that's going to play out.
I know such a cool change can change everything, especially when it has to do with being a camping little biznitch.
Exactly.
I mean, yeah,
but I don't feel like that's happened in this Halo, and I don't think it's because of crouching like that would change that. You know what I mean? I don't think in the past Halos you would get people camping like crazy all the time. You know, like it was thing. It was a legitimate strategy, right? No, but like I just feel like it's just a faster paced thing, and I think the radar is even so much more toned down now that, you know, you almost don't need it necessarily. Like, I feel like people get on top of you anyways, you know, so I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, there's certain times where it's useful, but I think you're right with the speed of the game kind of canceling it out, and especially the size of the maps. I could see it being abused in maps like Overgrowth, those really compact ones, you know, corner camping and stuff like that.
Stink anyways. But.
Yeah, they're terrible. They're terrible maps, but that's the situation where I could see it being a real, really big pain and just being... just game-breaking. Not game-breaking, but really frustrating.
It could be, but it could also be something that could bring you back in the game, you know, if you do lose the power weapon battle or something like that. If you don't have things and you're trying to get things going, you know, kind of slowing it down, hunkering down, and, like, being like, hey, let's chill here, wait for them to come out of the corner, get a beat, get a kill, and then try to turn the tides that way. So maybe it'll be something that evens it out a little more. Because, you know, some games can get one-sided. If someone controls weapons in the map, it can be pretty rough. So
yeah, it could definitely make it a little bit more strategic. You could really need to have to be able to think about what your moves are going to be. So I get that. So I took a look at Stasis. I don't know if you guys had a chance to see that new screenshot that they threw out there, but it looks like a Torque remix for this next map coming out. And I was really always kind of lukewarm on Torque. I never really thought it was that bad of a map, not that great of a map. It was just kind of like, you know, it's whatever. It's cool. Like, it played well for Fiesta, but, like, I don't know if I would want to play anything necessarily competitive on it. So the fact that they're bringing that into Arena, I mean, we'll see. I don't necessarily know.
Which one's Torque? Explain Torque again.
Torque's the one that's set out on, don't know if it's on a space station. I think it's on like a space station. It came out. It's got the pistons on the sides that go up and down,
and the yards that go up and down. Yeah. Okay. No. Yeah. With the sword in the middle and the hole.
Yeah.
I like that map.
Well, there you go. Stasis. Stasis is right up your alley. Then
it's got the cat stamp of approval right there.
They've been really throwing it in the playlist. Like, you play it quite a bit, and I've learned to really like it. Yeah, I like it. I'm in.
All right. Well, that'll be good then. You'll like that one when it comes out.
It's very even and linear.
That's true. It is. It does have those asymmetrical long sight lines.
Or linear.
Linear.
Longer. It is, though. It's decent as far as, you know, the advantages of one side gets another being asymmetrical and stuff like that. Symmetrical. Why am I talking about asymmetrical?
I have no idea. You got that word in your head.
I'm throwing A's around everywhere. I'm a quarter Canadian, I guess. So, hey. So there you go. Yeah, it's okay. I don't know that it really have an opinion on either way or the other.
I guess it'll be interesting to see, because the thing is, we loved Plaza and then Overgrowth comes out and it was terrible. So it's really hard to say based on what Torque is like if Stasis is going to be good.
Is it bad to say that I'm kind of liking Overgrowth?
No, you can't be saying that. Yes, it's terrible.
In fact,
it's terrible.
You cannot be on the podcast anymore.
I honestly have not
been voted off the island.
It's growing on me.
It's overgrowing on you, I think. Okay.
It's overgrown.
That's, yeah, okay.
I like it. I don't mind it. No, the only map that I think I said I've hated in the beginning and still hate is that stupid big team map, the ribs. The barrel
By the way, I think also I don't hate Overgrowth as much because I haven't played it as much.
Yeah, exactly. They took it out of the rotation.
That could be it. I don't completely hate it. Stamp of approval.
Oh, boom. Boy, just giving that thing out nowadays.
Yeah, it's pretty good day.
So GameSpot released a really cool interview with Unishek today and some more video gameplay of Infection, which looks really cool. Let me just talk about it before I give you my opinion on it. So basically, what they went through and how kind of this Infection came about and how the maps are kind of built is they had a little bit of a hackathon in a way, but essentially you were able to work on a project that you were feeling passionate about. Unishek went ahead and decided to kind of edit some maps. What did he take? Riptide. I think he took Overgrowth and one more and started editing them, adding
in Forge, by the way.
Yeah, and adding boxes, adding different parts to make it good for survivors, places to hide away from the zombies, things like that, or the infected, I guess. So it's really cool that it came out of something like that. That he's not a game designer, right? He's a community manager, and he went in and was like, "Yeah, I'm gonna work on this," and now we're kind of seeing what the outcome of that is. So it's really, really cool to see that. But talking about the infected and their abilities and how they move and those kinds of things, it's really interesting to see what they've done in the treatment, because in the past you were turned into a flood, right? So what was that? Halo 4? You were turned into a flood.
It was, right? Because you made the weird noise.
Yeah, you made the weird, like, horse goat names. Or yeah. Noises. Yeah. Halo 4, you turn into a flood. But in this one, you're going to turn... You just turn green, but you also are... You have a active camo on, but you're also kind of, like, smoking. You have, like, this sort of green trail that comes off you when you jump and run. Yeah, you're infected stench. You look really cool. I think that's sweet. I don't necessarily know I love the idea of being a flood, just because it's like, you're infected, you're a flood. Like, yes, that's terrifying. Like, you want to hide and run away from that. Now you're just kind of...
That noise.
Yeah. It's like you heard it across the map, and you're like, oh my god, where is it? You just flip around with your shotgun. You just want to rip off shots. They cannot... What can't they do? They can't sprint, which is cool. So they can just run or boost. They can just run around and clamber, but they have a little bit of a speed boost. And you have a sword. again, typical, but I think they definitely made some cool edits to that to change it up a bit and still keep really true to the essence. But they also left a ton of the weapons on the map, which I don't necessarily know how I feel about that. Sniper, you start with the shotgun, there's snipers on the map, there's the
pistol,
Hydra, pistol, you know, true infection is like what, shotgun and pistol and that's it?
Yeah, so, but yeah. The pistol is so much better though. Like they said in the article, like it's just the pistols. Like you, I feel like I would just be able to wreck everyone with the pistol. You know what I mean?
Are the zombies gonna have life in this game, or is it still one shot headshot?
One shot headshot.
It better be, because that was the essence of zombies. So I mean, in a zombie apocalypse, you can use any gun you want. So I like the idea of it. I mean, it's gonna play differently for sure. I don't know how that's gonna turn out. You're gonna fight over the sniper like crazy, though.
Here's the thing. Yeah, but I mean, they're going to come at you, I think, pretty quickly, so.
Well, it should only be one-shot headshots, though, not body shots, right?
I don't know. Probably.
Probably. Still would be, it'd be so cool if they could do it where you can't kill them. If they shot them in the body, you have to shoot them in the head.
That would be hard.
That would make the sniper rifle that much more skillful, though.
Well, yeah, but what if when they get up shotgun? Close and you just have a shotgun?
That's real zombie, though. You can't shoot them in the body.
But yeah, you can shoot them back with the shotgun, they'll fall down, then you can go up and like pop off shots in his head. These zombies are like,
yeah, maybe it'll ravenous. Knock him down still. I don't know. I'm thinking headshots are the way to go.
So the last thing that they added, which I really, really like, is last man standing, you reload faster. So you're just infinite ammo as well. So you're not like a sitting duck out there. You're able to actually like do some damage.
Two sword kills too.
There you go. You're even harder to kill. I love that. Yeah. I think that's so cool. Sweet. You're at the end, so make it fun. You know, give them a reward.
Make it epic.
Yeah, totally gets epic. And what they added into custom games and what last squad standing is, which is what we were talking about last week, is it's basically that same feeling of last mate and standing, but you're allowed to assign how many players get those boosts towards the end of infection. So it could be two people, it could be three people, it could be whatever you think that it should be, so that you can team up as a group of survivors to the end and try and like stick it out. So I think that's a really cool little
what.
So it's pretty cool that they added that feature in to have the last squad standing in the Forge mode, last man standing and actual infection. I'm really looking forward to diving into this game mode and checking it out. I think it's going to be a lot of fun. I don't know how long it's going to stick with us, but it's definitely going to be a fun social switch up from Arena.
I just like having it as an option. It's something to do when you're just sick of grinding out matchmaking.
Yeah.
We've all been waiting for this. I'm super excited.
Yeah.
It's cool. It's fun. It's competitive. You know, it's competitive in a way where it's still Halo and you're still shooting things, you know, but something you could do with people who maybe are on the same skill level as you, something like that, you know, and dragging them to an arena and having them get stomped or you having to carry them and stuff like that. Do something like this to have fun with it, you know?
Yeah, I mean, you get the feeling you want to stay alive, so it's like it's heart-pounding too.
Yeah,
like,
nah.
Think of the cool maps we're gonna download for our community play dates, dude. It's gonna be awesome.
Yeah, I mean, that's the cool thing, because Forgers, I don't know if you guys have been checking out like all the Forge creations specifically for Infection. There are so many awesome Forge maps for Infection, specifically designed for Infection, that people have been making, and they've just been waiting for these custom game settings to come along just to play them. And oh my god, I can't wait to just try those out.
People love it.
They do love it, and I'm gonna love it.
Hall map. Hall. It's a bunch of halls. I might have to make it myself if I don't see it soon.
Never ending halls?
Yeah, just halls everywhere. It's gonna be a big maze. Maybe with like big cord like arena rooms in the middle of it.
That would be terrifying to be running around in a maze and all of a sudden one of the infected comes around the corner.
It's gonna be all black shadows everywhere.
Well, that's the thing. You can like set the ambiance. There can be like fog and it'll be dark. Like, it's going to be fun. That's going to be so much fun.
I want to say I'm going to make one. Probably won't get around to it because I suck at that stuff.
I would crouch in the corner like a little girl the whole time.
Just I mean, I messed with the Forge and I couldn't even set a block. So I wouldn't count on me making a sweet map I'm thinking of.
You got to have
goals. You guys out there, though.
You got to have goals. You got to have goals for this one.
Learn how to set blocks
by the end of the year. Cat will have this maze ready.
He will have one block set by the end of the year.
One block. Yeah, no, I'm excited for it though. This is gonna be awesome.
The Halo Pro League, again, so this is, what, 3 weeks in a row now? This is the third weekend that there was professional Halo being streamed live. Like, this is so cool to be able to just turn on Twitch and have Pro Halo, having casters, the full production, everything that we've been waiting for. So this is the third weekend in a row. This was the LAN qualifier where it was 8 teams from the online qualifier went to Burbank, California. And 4 teams came out of the 8, and the other 4 got to go back into the general population. And good luck in the LCQ, because you're going to be fighting it out with everybody now in the LCQ for 2 spots. So there's a lot of work there.
What'd you think about them airing it on Mother's Day? Made it a little tough to watch.
Yeah, I mean, I only caught matches here and there, so it was a challenge because I had family in town. So yeah, it's hard.
I mean, gamers have moms too.
No way.
Yeah, it's true.
Hashtag. It's gonna be a movement.
Gamers have moms. New Halo
movement.
Gamers have moms. I actually ended up having to watch the stream today. I had to catch up on it because I wasn't able to watch it on Sunday. But what a
Fortunately, you're saying,
Halo on Sundays every week. Awesome. What?
Matt's over there trying to talk.
Go ahead, Matt. All right. Fortunately, I had a massive migraine all day. So I was like bedridden. So I just put on my phone and watched it for a little bit. So.
There you go. But you get the general gist of it. You see matches here and there, and there were some amazing plays. I mean, just Team Liquid, APG was in a car accident the day before the tournament actually went off. So, I mean, God, amazing for him. I mean, he got in there with stitches and in his face and was just doing work still. So shout out to them and Liquid. I mean, they didn't end up qualifying, which is too bad. But I mean, they got in there and they did work. So that's awesome. But let's get to the groups and talk a little bit about the teams that came out of each group. So first off, Group A, we had Enigma 6, Optic Gaming, Renegades, and Denial in Group A. And out of Group A, we had Enigma 6 and Renegades come out. So the crazy thing I gotta say here is Optic Gaming started off so incredibly strong with their first match against Renegades. Took them down and was going on to the winner brackets match against Enigma 6. Enigma 6 took them down and qualified. They punched their ticket. They are in the Halo Pro League.
They look good, by the
they
way,
do,
too.
Which is... I gotta say, surprising. I mean, maybe they're more of a LAN team because the online tournament or online qualifiers that they were in, they didn't look good. They didn't look like they had much. I mean, this was a completely different Enigma 6 team. Whether they needed more team to mesh or whatever it was, they're firing now.
They look good. They were killing it, like really good, like a lot. So I was very impressed.
I mean, good for them, especially Hook Boo Boo. Kratos, they're all 4 of those guys coming together now.
Who is the one guy, Kat?
Which one? For what?
For Enigma 6?
Hook, what do you mean? What one
guy? Hoobu? Hoobu Doobu?
Oh, Hoobu Doobu. Oh, you guys are making fun of me. Okay. I got it. You're making fun of me.
Sorry.
I can't even remember because I tried to push that out of my head. I got to get their names right. It's hard.
Yeah, I was going to be stuck there again.
Boo-doo-boo, goo-boo, I don't know. Just a sweet name. I like it. It was pretty complicated at first.
Boo-boo, take my doo-boo.
It's kind of a crazy name. All right?
Yeah. All right. Sorry for that distraction.
All right, back on
boo-boo,
back on
take my doo-boo. All right, here we go. So Optic Gaming lost to Enigma 6, and then they went back on to rematch with Renegades. And I was thinking that they were going to be able to take them again. Maybe it'd go six games. And I don't know what happened after losing to Enigma 6, but they did not show up against Renegades. They got thoroughly beat on every map, every game type that they played against Renegades.
Yeah.
Stopped.
As you were saying, they looked so upset just afterwards. They're so...
I mean, they just didn't have energy. I mean, they were just like, they looked tired. They looked like they didn't have focus. They weren't playing together as a team. They just were so off. You know, that's all I can think of to describe the way they were playing. Because with the way they started out of the gates, I mean, they came out so strong. They looked like this was the Optic Halo team that they've been looking for.
But even when they beat Renegades, they didn't seem pumped about it, you know? Like, which is, it wasn't that energy.
What's going on there? I mean...
Oh, maybe we got some high emotions running on the team.
There's no emotions running on the team.
Well, high negative, which makes you quiet. It's like a double negative.
It's crazy.
Something.
Oh, double negative would make a positive.
Whatever it is, they got to sort it out because this is their last shot. You know, they need to be able to
shake it off.
They
you
need
know?
To shake it Ooh, off.
Get now, back in there.
I must say, as much as maybe the body language didn't look good, and I noticed that was one of the first things I noticed, but Renegades did play well that second.
They did.
They stepped up. You know, maybe it was that type of thing where they thought they were going to go roll with it again.
And I got to say about Renegades, I was really impressed with Commonly. To be honest, I thought he played very well with that team. I think he fits in nicely with all of the different roles that they have on that team, and I think he is playing to his strengths right now. With Ninja Victory X and Penguin. I mean, even Penguin, holy crap, that guy went off in that last series against Optic. He was so strong all over the map, just racking up multi-kills and going on sprees. He looked very strong, and I think Renegades is starting to round into form as well.
Yeah,
I'm really glad to see Commonly do better and do well, just because I had high hopes of them.
Yeah, I mean, it was tough the way last season ended, having won X Games Gold, coming into the World Championships. You're like, oh man, they're riding high. They took down CLG. You thought they'd make some moves, but tough ending, and especially getting dropped. Another tough way to move on, but. Again, I think he's looking for his role, and I think he's found it with the team that he's on.
He made some sweet flagpoles and runs.
Yeah, he did.
Stuff like that. He really did.
Yeah, he's a very selfish player. I like that. He's there to win. He's not there for statistics.
I think that's the way you got to be. That's right. How the most successful teams are. He definitely led his team a few times with assists, getting those team shots, so... you know, I'm happy for him. Happy for that team to be moving on, but disappointed for Optic. I was pulling for him.
I know you really like Optic.
The only reason is because I like Nated. I'm pulling for Nated. Really, I just want him to do well.
So if we're talking about players, man, I'm almost pulling towards Allegiance because of Ryan Noob. I found out the other day. Actually, one of our listeners, Method, was on. And I was looking through my friends list, and I put it together. I must have been friends with this kid in Halo 3 days, maybe Halo 2. I don't know if he played very much Halo 2. But I made friends with him back in the days you made friends through Xbox and actually playing games because there really wasn't the party system. So you made friends with the players you were playing with. I'm saying I must have been playing pretty good if for some reason he's on my friends list. There's only a couple reasons he'd be on my friends list. I played good. We played together. We actually played with each other. Or we may have played in a tournament at one point in time because we were doing that a little bit. We could have met him through there. Or
he was drawn to your personality and your jokes.
Must have been the jokes. but no. Or the other reason could be we got so pissed off at each other in a game, we friended each other and played 1v1. Tell me any other scenario.
Well, you love doing 1v1, so I'm not really surprised that could be an option.
Yeah, maybe we found each other in a different game. Who knows? But that's
remember we played Halo 3 and I carried you guys all to like level 49s and I think we almost got to 50 the one time. And yeah, you guys remember that?
No, I never.
I'm guessing that's what it was. It was like me carrying Cat to 49 and him being a higher level. And this guy being like, oh, well, maybe I should make more friends of people who are higher level. And then you forgot about him because you never played with him because you got carried.
I'm not sure why you are lying to all of our listeners.
Got carried.
Every single one. No, I was going through our old statistics for these games. I had 25,000 matchmaking kills or 25,000 custom games and like 16,000 matchmaking. We played a lot of that games. So I was going through Ryan Noob's profile and he has 25,000 custom kills. And I mean, I only play Arena. Well, now that we're playing custom games, but with my matchmaking now at level 70 something, 74, I only have 12,000 kills. That's a lot of playtime, and that's probably not his only name.
That's scrimming right there for you.
That's cool.
Yeah, so Allegiance, as you mentioned them, they are one of the teams that qualified.
Yeah. They played awesome. They crushed it.
Yeah, they came out of Group B. So Group B had a Team Allegiance, Team Liquid, Envious, and Soul Red. ALG Allegiance took the win over Envy. And then once Envy got knocked into the loser's bracket, they came back strong and took out Team Liquid to move on as well. So we've got Envy and Allegiance qualifying for Halo Pro League out of Group B. I'm not surprised really about Envy, but it's awesome to see Allegiance making it out there.
Yeah, Allegiance came out as like a top performing team, I thought. They really didn't let up the entire time, took both their games. Very, very strong team.
Okay.
So, yeah. We're going to see a lot from them, that's for sure.
Yeah. I think they had the easier bracket, by the way, though.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, Group A was definitely like a group of death, you could say. I mean, any one of those teams could roll. Poor Denial was in there, but I mean, any of those teams could roll. And we saw it came out there. But I mean, definitely ALG, Envy came out. And Soul Red and Team Liquid are going back into the pool to try and win a spot from the LCQ.
Yeah, Team Liquid went up against a couple hard teams, that's for sure.
I mean, they went up against Envious. Envious looks strong. They definitely retooled their lineup, Pistola, McQuinn, L-Town. They're definitely looking really strong. So they ran into a tough team for sure, but I think... I mean, so out of the four that have made it, Allegiance, Renegades, Envious, and Enigma 6, are there any surprises for you guys out of those four that made it? Or is that kind of what you were thinking was going to happen?
Yeah, I mean, I put Soul Red to be at the bottom. Anyways, I don't really know too much about them. That's kind of really why they're new in my mind. And Team Liquid... Yeah, I put those two losing. I mean, with what we came up against. But Renegades and Optic, I guess we're fighting for that last spot. I think I was rooting a little more Optic.
Oh, come on. What is the sound effects for over there? I know your team's Renegades.
But no, I'm pumped on Allegiance now. And Envious is...
Yeah, that was your team. You like McQuinn.
McQuinn and Pistola combo is awesome, and they crushed it again. We were watching one game. McQuinn had a couple weird times where he would go out kind of headstrong with the sniper rifle, not reloaded. So he's a very aggressive, I don't want to say spazzy player.
Spastic.
That could be a gamer tag.
Pizzazz.
Zazz. No, he's like a very Twitch player. I love it. I mean, that's how I play. And I was watching him on Coliseum. It was just awesome. So I'm pumped on them guys. And yeah, I mean, what we saw, I kind of expected. So right. Other than Optic, but Optic and Renegades and them, they were all on the same player level. So one of them was gonna drop down regardless.
Somebody had to not make it. Matty, what about you? Any surprises for you?
I mean, just the Enigma 6 played so well out of that group. That was a little surprising. Maybe we should expect that, but it was still a little surprising. And then, I mean, Renegades coming back in that last game and doing what they had to do. You know, I was rooting for them, but it was still a little surprising to me as far as, like, oh, wow, they actually played that well and got it going, you know? So
yeah, I'm right there with you on that one on both points. I mean, Enigma 6, again, I was kind of like, I was not expecting them to be as strong as they were. I guess before all the qualifiers started, once I saw the roster, I was like, yeah, look at their lineup. I mean, they have a lot of strong guys on their team. I was expecting them to be a tough team. But once we saw them play in the qualifiers, online qualifiers, I was a little bit especially PAX and then the online qualifiers, I was kind of just like, this is not the team I was expecting. And the fact that they came out and made the statement that they did is really awesome. And I'm hoping that it is just the fact that they got more time together and they're going to be a top team to go forward in Pro League. But again, pretty frustrated that OG, Optic Gaming, did not make it in. And this kind of leads a little bit into the weekly intel. But, you know, their body language, their mental state is something that I think a lot of people were looking at and questioning, because coming off the loss to Enigma 6, going into Renegades, energy was low. I don't know if they had their focus, because really they just look lost out there.
Yeah, I mean, there's time left. And before seeing the body language and how they took the loss, I would have definitely said Optic's going to make it.
Yeah.
At the end of this, I would have guaranteed it. But seeing their body language and kind of how they took the loss is giving me big doubts. Big doubts.
We got big doubts over there with Kat.
Got big doubts.
So cool those doubts.
cool your doubts.
They're kind of an up and down team, though. So.
They are. When they're on, they're on. When they're off, they're ice cold. I mean, they need to be on more than off. You know,
maybe they've hit the rock bottom. Now they're gonna fight their way to the top.
I mean, they made it through the LCQ last season, so hopefully we'll see that again, and they'll be one of the two to snag it. Before we move on to the weekly intel, I want to get your guys' predictions. Top two spots from the LCQ. Who do you think's gonna snag them out of Optic, Denial, Soul, Red, Team Liquid, or a team that we haven't thought of out of those four?
I think Optic's gotta make it in.
I know, I mean, that's what I want to say so bad.
There's too many names, too much skill going
that's
there
not,
to
there's
not
too,
do
too
it.
Too much experience. It's a team full of vets. I don't see a way they don't make it.
I think all teams that can beat them are already in, essentially. I'm not sure anyone, unless we come up with one of the unknowns coming up and then beating them. But I think it's a throw a bunch of names up in the air and see which one falls, you know, as far as the second bid. So it would be fun to see a giant scramble and see what happens. Because I don't think Denial's are strong anymore. I've never bought into Liquid. But I'm sure it's probably going to come back and bite me and they'll curb stop everyone. But, and then, you know, we'll see what happens. But, you know, I think it could be something where could be a random team coming in.
All right. Who are your two? Let's throw down here. Who are your two?
Well, I'm going Optic, and then I'm going the field.
Optic in the field. Okay, Kat.
I'm going to go Optic Liquid.
All right. Because
Liquid had some really strong matches. They played some tough teams, but they had what it takes. I really think they can. If they bring it, they can. With the team that they're playing against, I mean, I'm excited for the field, but that's my guess. I'm going
to
stick with it.
I want to disagree. Well, not disagree. I want to pick two different teams, but those were the two I was thinking. I was thinking Optic and Liquid, but to change it up, I'm going to go Optic and Soul Red are going to make it in.
Oh, you're going to do Soul Red?
I think Soul Red's going to take it online. Maybe they don't have it in LAN. That's fine. They're going to make it into LCQ online.
Sure.
That's what I'm guessing. So,
YOLO.
yeah, exactly. So, weekly
intel.
You only land once. Can we get a shirt that says that?
We should. Well, I don't know if you can follow an acronym up with an acronym in there. Like, it's like just
Yo Lano. Yo Lano.
I don't know. Doesn't really work. Anyways.
It works. We'll take it.
All right.
So the weekly intel this week, we want to talk about a lot about what we're discussing with Optic and their mental state, and also, you know, not just focusing solely on pro players, but also let's take a look at players like us that just play. I don't want to say casual, but you know, we're not going to be professional players. We just play with friends and do some matchmaking, and how your mental state can affect how you play, how you have teamwork, and everything that goes along with that when you're playing Halo as a team. So let's jump into that topic right now.
Right, meow.
Let's do it.
Meow.
All right. Mental state of players. So, I mean, let's just kick it off talking about Optic and going back to last season, even. So I'm focused purely on Nated right now. I love him as a player. I really like following his gameplay. I like his style, but his energy and his where he's at mentally really is a little bit frustrating to watch as a fan, because he's so good when he's high energy, he's focused, he's really making call outs with his teams. But anytime you see him deflated or tired or out of it, the team kind of reflects how he's playing. Same thing happened with Allegiance last year when he was on that team, and now being on Optic, it seemed like that's the same thing that happened at this LAN qualifier.
I know, it's having somebody with such a strong personality that can drive the team like that is a godsend and your worst enemy. It can go either way. If he is pumped and you're, because you know, if they're crushing it, he's pumped, he's screaming, it's such high energy. But, and they say it's, well, they were saying as soon as he gets quiet, then he really starts working. But as soon as he gets quiet, he really can bring the whole team to his energy level.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you think about it for, I mean, really for, and I don't necessarily like talking about the comparisons between traditional sports and esports, but it really does relate very well. Like, if you have a leader, your captain on your team, that isn't fully invested or fully focused or is tired that day, your team feeds off of the energy of who you have being your leader that specific day that you're competing. So having Nated be drained like that, it definitely does take a toll on how his team performs. And I think that's a really key thing to keep in mind for players like us when we play as well, because we'll hop on someday and maybe you're tired after work or you didn't have a good day, so you're not necessarily in the best mood, or even taking it when you're in a great mood, you're drunk and you're happy, your energy's high. There's like so many different swings that you can take and how that affects how you play. And especially rolling into kind of tilting and raging like MattyIce tends to do every once in a while. I mean, it really does have an effect on how you play. So like, how, for example, like what do you do to stay kind of balanced and in the game and preventing yourself from getting, you know, too high, too low, or off your game?
Yeah, you say your team, well, going for pro teams, I guess team leaders, but I mean anybody on your team with the negative attitude is going to bring the whole team down. If you're not on the same page, you're doomed. No, but it does affect everybody on your team. I guess to stay balanced is, the ways that I do it, well, we can just take a break, which kind of helps. All right, I'm just going to go chill out for minutes and watch YouTube.
Better go chill out.
Yeah. But no, it's just, you can't let things get to you. I mean, sometimes players are going to get good kills on you. I guess your best bet's to not... You get this all the time in Halo, just, oh, that was crap. That was a glitch kill. Right. That wasn't... Like, you got to take the blame yourself and just work on getting better. Like, if you're blaming the game 98% of the game, it's probably not the game. And it's a very fair game. There are some crappy things that happen and laggy shots and stupid things like that, but just let that roll off. You know, it wasn't your skill level, it was the game, and things are obvious, but you just gotta let things roll off, basically.
That's a great point, because you gotta take the positive in situations like that, because if you're going up against a team or an individual player that's really performing well and is on that match, maybe you matched up against them in a previous match and you didn't have these issues, but he's on that next match. If you're getting dominated by a specific player or a team, think about what they're doing and learn from it and try and bring those points into the way you're playing and change the way you're playing for that match or going forward, because they're doing something right, obviously, and it's not the game that's helping them. They are doing something good.
That is such a great point that you say that change your game up, because you can almost judge your, when you're like really focused and people are killing you, you're getting bummed. You can really tell by how you're feeling on how you're playing. So if you are getting just rolled, change your play style up. That it's a big giveaway to start trying new things. honestly, if you're going to die a million times and lose anyways, what's it going to hurt to try some new play styles? So that's a really good way to stay balanced. If you're getting rolled, just try something new, something that you haven't thought of, some different trails, or just try to survive, like work on your survive skill. It doesn't have to be, you don't have to just run out there and die every 2 seconds. You can just try something else. Mm-hmm. That's actually perfect, a great way to stay balanced. I should use it.
Once in a while, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm pretty sure that if I'm not performing well, it's either the game's fault or the controller's fault.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
That's the key.
Nine
always,
times out of ten.
Always, yes. Blame the equipment, too.
Secretly, every time I'm saying that, I'm referencing MattyIce.
Pretty much. And I have...
the game.
I have self-diagnosed as having an issue with this. In the past, more so than now, I will say, though.
You've been a lot better. And
I have.
When me and Lokes were on and you rage kicked your Xbox and it logged you off, I really just thought you rage quit and didn't even say bye.
Did that have anything to do with the... Well, it had something to do with the gameplay, but what else did it have to do with teammates?
It had something to do with you throwing an errant grenade right into me.
It was throwing a grenade where I wanted it to go.
You couldn't accept the blame of killing Sergeant.
No.
And you kicked your Xbox.
I threw the grenade directly where I wanted it to go, and Sergeant decided that's where he needed
to
be as well. All right,
so this scenario.
Yeah, this is a
great... We're on the rig. We're... In the room underneath Plasma Caster spawn, so you got
under nest,
little elbow room, and Sergeant Bobcat's in the beginning.
I was on the box.
In the beginning of it, down below, and the enemy.
No,
player,
it wasn't down below.
No, I was up top. I was on the box.
Yeah, you're on the box. That's in between.
Yeah.
So the enemy player ran through the beginning and ran around the corner to the left, like going towards sniper spawn. Exiting out that side, and MattyIce threw the grenade in the opening of the beginning where you.
No, I didn't. I threw the grenade where he was going. The guy entered. No.
He would have thrown it to the left.
No,
he entered
from sniper side
going. Yes,
from sniper side going towards the.
Okay, I got it backwards.
Spawn.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, so I was throwing a grenade to the entryway that he was going to. And
but he didn't come all the way around the side is the thing.
That was my fault he didn't come. You know,
I was chasing him back through the tunnel. I'm gonna let that comment pass. I was chasing him through the tunnel to force him back out to the other side. The thing is, this is a great learning experience right here.
My grenade had bounced.
You know what?
This is days ago.
This is the issue right here. You will not give up on this, and I'm trying to rationalize it, use it as a learning experience, and you are still going off on this point.
I have no problem with being in unfortunate circumstances, an unfortunate series of events,
if you
will.
What about the stick when you jumped... and I threw a grenade 50 yards and it hit you and you said I did it on purpose.
We watched that video together. I was in midair when you threw it.
You are always right, we've learned.
This is 99.7% of the time, actually.
And
they've done the math.
This kind of goes back to, I think, two things. One, communication as a team. You need to be able to have these situations
happen.
I'm not
going to say I'm throwing a grenade.
Or avoid them. No. I'm just saying I could have communicated the fact that he's coming in the tunnel, but I'm forcing him back to the left. I'm forcing him back to the left to prevent you from throwing that grenade in the first place.
Well, maybe.
To communicate what I'm trying to accomplish on the play.
Yeah. One episode we also talked about unnecessary grenades.
I think it's a matter of understanding who's...
I was just trying to hit him as he was coming out of the entranceway.
It's an understanding of...
I was just trying to hit him across the map.
What your teammates... You need to be able to rely on your teammates to make those plays and then help out with team shooting. And I think it comes down to being able to play your role, play your position, control your area of the map. There's so much more that plays into it than just, you know, one thing. So I think it's just a good situation to learn from. For many reasons, with communication and map awareness, but also the ability to communicate and fight off rage situations, tilting, things like that. Because we weren't playing well in that match. We were losing.
I was taking it thoroughly.
Yeah, we were
places
getting,
that don't want to take
it. Well, that's the thing. We were getting rolled, and it just... multiplied, it compounded by having situations like that where we're team killing, and it's hard to stay level-headed and to come back and refocus. Okay.
So being my teammates, because you guys are my teammates, and knowing my personality, perhaps you should not taunt me in that situation.
Okay, I'll take responsibility for
the
taunt.
I was about to say that.
I'm admitting my faults too. But
we didn't need to taunt you. It's just that you just get so seriously mad about it. It's hard to let you win.
I hate losing very
and
much.
I didn't have to chime in there and agree with Sergeant. I could have let it roll off. It was just a domino effect of a dying teammate. We were just tired. It was end of the night.
Yeah.
We were just doing terrible.
Well, that's the thing. You just need to
know that we lost.
You need to realize what your energy level's at, how you're playing, everything that goes into that, because it all affects you mentally. Because we got to a point at that game. I think we were kind of on a down spiral at that point. We were just all kind of negative. Yeah. And we weren't trying to make the plays. We were just trying to be like, let's try and just somehow get through this and win. And it wasn't necessarily a team game at that point. You know, I think we were just so frustrated that it wasn't going our way.
I think this is something that can kind of go into, like, when you look at something like Optic and you look at the pros when they do these series and stuff. It's very hard to, even in a tournament, like when you have a bad game and it starts to steamroll, it's very hard to stop that snowball.
Yeah.
It's really hard. Even if you may not be doing something else and the other team's just doing something right, like you're just unable to adjust the way you need to, and you're unable to to try to figure out, you know, and this is where you see, I think, the good teams come through, is that they do adjust. They figure out a way to identify what's going on quickly. Quickly, I think, is the key, because I think you can identify it long term if you go back and look at the film and stuff like that. But being able to identify it quickly and then, you know, figure out what it was and then changing it. I mean, that's I think where you see this big gap between the teams. You know, if CLG is in a close game, or if they lose a game, which doesn't happen very often, like you see them, you know, the next game they're back in it. They're not, you know, nothing.
It's fresh. It's a fresh game.
Right. I mean, they're not hanging their heads. They don't think they're going to lose. And I think that's another aspect of it is the confidence level. You know, I mean, that's something I don't think that we saw Optic have any confidence. Even when they won, when they beat Renegades, you didn't see their confidence at all. Like, they were like, okay, we won. Like, I don't know, maybe they were expecting that. And that's a form of confidence. But it didn't seem the same as we would expect something from Nated, you know? Like, it was completely different. And it's weird. And it's such a my bachelor degree in psychology, so I kind of gone over a bunch of this stuff and applied it to traditional sports in a lot of ways. But it's such a hard thing to change when, like, this snowball effect happens, and trying to turn things around is just extremely difficult, and it's crazy. So I don't know.
So how much of this do you put on the coach to be able to refocus the team, either mid-match or between matches, to say, all right, guys, we lost that one. It doesn't matter. Yes, we did some things wrong. We need to refocus because this is a new match coming up, and we can't continue to lose these matches. We need to get back on the right track so that we can stay in the series.
Yeah, it's credit to the coaches of being able to keep your team positive and, like, ready to go. And while criticizing them, giving them pointers, they have to be very receptive to their coach. You got four unbelievable players, especially on your top teams, and being told by, I mean, the coach that's, like, good at paying attention to the game. But you always get that, I feel like in sports you get that, like, you know, that big ego. And being able to keep your ego down and listen to your criticism of your coach and paying attention to stuff like that, like, that's where you're right. You really do see shine in the top playing teams. They're able to adjust. They can listen to their coach. They've got the receptivism to outside criticism from that stuff, and they can tune their gameplay to that. And, I mean, Nated having such a strong personality, maybe you could definitely see clashing on a personality like that when you're trying to tell them, like, listen, you got to do this or try doing this, and you get that mentality of, I'm the pro, I'm playing.
Well, I mean, it's hard to say that in that situation, since the coach is Flamesword. You know, they're such peers on that level. He's been at it in the professional game for so long. But I also got to say that it's potentially a factor that he has only been coaching for such a short time. Also, maybe. You know,
yeah, that's true.
He hasn't been a coach for long enough like a guy like Clutch or Towie or Lumnite, where those guys are phenomenal coaches for their teams for CLG, Envy, and EG. It's something to be said where, you know, Flamestore might need to be able to get a little bit of experience under his belt to understand how his team reacts emotionally when they're in stressful situations, how he can kind of insert his input into the conversation and get them refocused for the next match. Because I think that's a very finely tuned skill for coaches to have.
It's an extremely difficult thing to master, too, as far as like even something like calling a person out on something they did wrong or something like that. Like, there's a right way to do it and there's a wrong way to do it. And those can be completely different ways when you're a player compared to being a coach. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's a number of different, like, the traditional sports. I mean, they've obviously have a head start in this coaching thing. And I mean, there's so many different books and all these research that's done on coaching and how to coach and how to do all this stuff and how to do, you know, the right way, the wrong way, different techniques. I mean, you know, I don't know how much of that applies to like something like this, and I don't know how much the coaches are actually using stuff like that. I mean, anything like that could be enormously beneficial in a game like Halo, because a lot of it is mental, you know. You know, there's the physical reaction time part of it and stuff like that, but I mean, it's not like you're a running back who runs a 4-2-8 and you just get the ball and then think, you know, your instincts take over, you know, like, right. This is like a completely, like, there's instincts and everything, but it's a lot of it's just mental and knowing where to go and stuff like that, and keeping your head calm. And you know, I feel like that's something that, I mean, I don't know. It's going to be a growing process. Let's put it that way. It's going to be a process with this. Mm. I don't think it's as easy as, oh, he's a good player and he's good. This is something they said in yesterday. You know, they said he's, you know, a good player and he's just been playing for so long that when he makes call outs, we know that, you know, he's making the right call out, we follow it. Well, okay, that's one aspect of it. Now, where's the rest of the stuff that goes along with the coaching? So it's something that, I don't know, it's going to take a while. And I mean, hopefully they'll figure it out, because I'd like to see them, you know, in the league. So
yeah, absolutely. I mean, you look at a coach like Towie for EG. I mean, he's such a calm and focused guy behind each of those players when they're playing. I think, you know, he's put out a really great series of coaching videos and what their input is and how coaching affects Halo teams. He's put a great series out on his YouTube channel. And it's definitely worth watching if you don't have any idea what coaches really do for these teams. And, you know, he's just such a big influence and a really smart guy for that team that I think – he has been able to finally tune those skills, because it's one thing to be a player and know the game and then step into a coaching role. It's another thing to really understand people and how to relate and how to communicate effectively in a way that keeps people focused and moving forward and not discouraged.
Yeah. Yep. It's crazy to think how much emotion plays into the fact of these teams doing and how they actually play and while they're playing. And the craziest thing is, like you guys are saying, keeping, when you're talking about the actual tournament aspect of this, you got to keep your emotions through the entire tournament. And Matthew is saying that sometimes they're just getting the drop on you. I mean, you're playing against the best people in the world, and keeping your emotions solid through all that's just unbelievable. And that's where you do see your best teams, the ones that can control their emotions. Because you see us playing online, we get tired, we start sucking and yelling about
that's it.
Other throwing grenades, and then we're out. You know, we'll just kick our Xboxes and you won't hear from us because we're hundreds of miles away. I guess online you can do that, but in the LAN tournaments, these are tough. I mean, you're there, you're in these people's faces.
Yeah. There's a lot of pressure to be able to bounce. I mean, just think about yourself. Zero pressure, essentially, and how emotionally invested and worked up we get anytime you play a match.
What do we get out of it if we win? We get a win. It doesn't even matter. None of this even matters. They're playing for money.
I mean, it goes to show how competitive we are, but at the same time, it's like we're just playing for bragging rights, essentially. You know, we're not doing this for anything.
It's not our livelihood.
Exactly.
Think of the emotions that go into fighting for your money.
Yeah, for your paycheck.
Gosh, I love gambling, and it just makes it so exciting. my emotions would be crazy. If I lost, I'd be flipping out probably.
Well, I know that just goes to credit these guys. Like, yeah. You got to think
it's crazy
how much they are depending on winning these tournaments. You know, right now these aren't for money, but once you get into pro league, there's a lot riding on it, and to be able to stay controlled, I mean.
Their emotions are so magnified compared to what we deal with on a daily basis.
Yeah. But why do you see like Optic last weekend not showing emotion at all?
Well, that's
like,
the thing.
How does that come through? You know what I mean?
Like, how do you show emotion when you're so mad at each other, but you're televised?
Well, we don't know if they were.
I'm just saying that's an example.
Yeah.
Like when you get quiet and they're not communicating well. I don't know. They could just all be down, but it's hard to show. Like, they have to contain their emotions. They're being nationally – they're being televised in the world. So a lot of people watching, and they know that their sponsors are watching. So they have to contain their emotion a lot more than us arguing about a grenade toss for 3 minutes while playing the game, you know?
I mean, you definitely see them get fired up at times. There's definitely been times where they get a little hot and argue every once in a while. But, yeah, I mean, the thing is, it's hard to say if it was – restraining their emotions because they were, you know, steaming and they didn't want to bring it out on the stream, or if they were just flat-out emotionless. Like, they were just so flat. It's hard to say.
Which is what it seemed like, you know?
Which is what it seemed like. And if that is the case, what is going on? Like, it's hard to really understand what's going through their heads at that point.
Yeah.
I mean, there was something, because they didn't play the way they'd been playing all tournament in that last match.
Yeah.
I mean, like I said, the last two matches, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Something switched, and when they got beat, they went downhill quick, you know? Like, seriously.
Yeah.
So,
it goes back to what you're saying. Once the snowball starts rolling, it's hard to stop it.
Yeah, it's a bummer. They should use our tip of, you know, just try something different. sure they've done that.
But. I mean, so that's a great point. So to wrap this weekly intel, what's a big – each of you, what's your top tip, top two? What things to keep in mind when you're playing? Maybe your emotions are getting away from you. How do you stay in check?
I mean, I do
– Yeah, what do
like,
you do?
deep breaths. Well, and I've gotten better. And
you have. You have gotten a million times better.
I'm much better than I used to be.
It was
like,
at least a rage
Halo
for the
3.
Night, probably. That's how you usually end your night. It's just a rage.
Yeah, it usually did end that way.
So
you've gotten it together. And I mean, it shows, and it's great because it
makes us playing the game more fun when you're not.
Well, and it's a lot of it is my understanding of, like, I got a lot into, like, the sports psychology and stuff like that when I was playing soccer in college, and that was after those rage quitting days, really. You know, and it was – especially like my last year of it, like it was just something where I really focused on when things start to go badly and start to feel like the snowball going on, of like completely changing your thinking, deep breaths, you know, like literally, like not even like when you say change your thinking, not like, oh, I'm gonna think differently, but like repeatedly saying what you want it to be like, you know. And I don't necessarily do that when we're playing Halo, but I would do that when I'm playing soccer. So now it's just like a natural thing for me to be like, all right, deep breath, we're getting smoked, what can I do differently, you know, not run out there this time, let's go this way, or do something like that. So it just slows down a lot more as far as like my thinking goes, I guess. Slow things down. There you go.
Yeah,
kind of what Kat was saying too.
Kat, what you got?
You're super, super in your head. That's for sure.
Yep.
I guess my big tip is just relax. You know, you're playing, you're having fun. You could be working. That's really my my thing. Working, which I do 90% of my life. And that's what keeps me going. I'm playing Halo. It's awesome. I've really gotten okay at losing because I'll just hop on it and play by myself with three randoms.
Yeah.
We lose all the time. So yeah. I honestly have just gotten okay with winning or losing. I'm just playing games. I don't even care. I'm just so happy to be playing video games and not sitting at a desk working. That's my motivation.